Hello, this is National Chess Master R. Ratz. I'm here to examine a game played in Team 4545 League between Crypto Chess and Prezekzhony. I'm sorry, I can't pronounce it. Prezekzhony. I apologize if I butchered it, which I'm sure I did. Anyway, this was elected as Game of the Week for Week 1 of Team 57 event. And as always, I make a video of the game of the week. Now, sadly, from last event, my friend Enfork, Fide Master, is not here to give his analysis. But anyway, this is what we have. I ran through the game already, and it's a pretty interesting game. Both players are rated over 2,000, and it's certainly a fighting game. Sadly, nobody saved it to their library. You know, this is one of the ideas. When you nominate a game, you want to save it to your library before it disappears from their history. That way we have the timestamps every move, what took place. The timestamps are still preserved on the league website, and I looked through it, and it seemed both players took their time. But anyway, for future use, if you're paying attention or nominate a game, save it, okay? Also, let's see. I was in Las Vegas from Thursday through early Monday morning. Up there for the I had two students flying from out of state to play in the Scholastic events, and I was there to coach them all weekend. And I'm happy to say they both won a couple trophies. And then at the same time, I was there to observe the National Open. And I got a chance to meet ICC co-owner Late Night, also known as Marty Grund, and ICC administrator Bill Scotty, who has been associated with the Team 4545 League. And it was a lot of fun meeting a lot of people, seeing some old friends, and I won't bore you to death with what took place there. Let's get on to this. Okay. Starts out as a perk defense, but I don't think it ever really becomes a perk defense because Black never fianchettos his bishop, okay. So it's similar in some respects to the Hanham variation of the Philidor defense. In that, White is playing knight f3 in the fourth move, and Black might play e5 or knight bd7 first. Followed by e5, and it becomes something like the Hanham variation. But here the queen comes out for an early sortie. And White's kind of playing it like a perk, expecting Black to go into the perk with the Austrian attack moves, but Black never does. So here we have e5, and that's why I say it's similar to the Philidor defense. But then again, it's not quite a Philidor defense, because White's second move against the Philidor is to play knight f3, and now he's got his f-pawn out. So I don't know what you call this opening. But it's interesting, to say the least. And I don't know if h3 was really needed. I guess maybe he's planning to put the bishop on e3, and he doesn't want the knight kicking it. But why weaken the king side? Unless he's planning a pawn storm. Sometimes a good alternative, if you want to put the bishop on e3 and you want a safe haven for it, you slide the king over to h1. Then you can play bishop e3, and if the bishop gets kicked, you can drop back to g1, for what it's worth. Okay. Now White decides he doesn't want the queen on a5. I don't know. Maybe he should have gone to c7 immediately. White wasn't certainly threatening any kind of discovery. The bishop wasn't on d2, lining up a potential discovery against the queen. So in effect, Black has given up a tempo, but it to some degree is kind of insignificant now unless the position opens up. So maybe White should try to open up the position. Let's see. Let's take a look at that. It could give him an isolated e-pawn, but well, White doesn't really have complete development yet either, but let's see. I'm not saying this is all forest. We'll come back and look at it. There's a nice tempo on the queen with development. Now, let's see. Do we want to play e5 and chase that knight? Let's see. Now, you might have to take it, or you could play knight e4 and preserve it. Let's see. I don't know, it might be premature to do this, but I don't know. Now they both have an isolated pawn. If he takes with a pawn, he could take with a queen. I don't know. This doesn't seem like enough for white. Looks like black's okay. White just doesn't have enough firepower yet. Well, I don't know. Let's see. Queen h5, daring black to castle. But then, who knows? Black may opt to try to castle queenside here. I don't know. It's interesting. It's not forced. But white could try to develop a little more and then bust the position open. So anyway, bishop e3. So now that white black's castled, maybe we could do something with the lines I was just giving. Remember I said daring black to castle? Let's try and bust it open now, just for the fun of it. Now, I was saying before, none of these things are forced, but maybe they are. Let's see. The knight can go back to e8, and white can hold on to this for a while, but if takes. Now white's lost a tempo in this line because the bishop went to f4 in one move, right? Now it's not. It's going there in two moves. Now e5 again. And here white could play queen h5 directly, then on g6, he's going to lose, have to give up the bishop here. I don't know, let's see here. Now queen h5. Now there's a mate threat. Okay, so white's got an attack on h7 that needs to be dealt with. G6 and queen h6. I don't know if this is enough yet. Looks like black should probably weather this storm. It's not clear how white's going to get more pressure on g7. The idea is to maybe play bishop g5 at some point and get it to f6, but black will just chop it off. It's just another line worth analyzing. Sit down and analyze this and try and maybe find a better move. Maybe white could try h4 and h5. Anyway, he doesn't do this. He opts for the slow approach. He's going to get these pawns rolling. He's got a nice pawn storm. But I have a feeling either line is probably okay for both sides, but the lines I just suggested are waste for those that like to attack. What can you do? And if you're playing a postal chess game, they call them online chess now, you examine possibilities, you carry them out and see what kind of ideas you could develop. It really helps your analysis skill, helps you recognize patterns. Then you can sit and, when you're playing an over-the-board game, be able to analyze long continuations. So black opts to grab the bishop pair, and white's got a space advantage and a slight development advantage. Black still needs to develop his queen bishop. Okay, so let's see. He doesn't develop it yet. And now the queen's going back. Lost a lot of time with that queen, black. You could have had your bishop out. Okay, so a3. Now he picks the knight. I guess he didn't want it to tempo his queen on c7. And I don't know, this kind of helps white a little bit. He's able to now start transferring this knight over to the king side, where it might be able to combine with other forces and generate some threats. Okay, now here comes a discovered threat again that black doesn't want any part of it, so he moves his queen again. And little threat down here on b2. And white ignores it, at least for now, and black stops the threat by occupying a square that blocks it. And now it seems like this knight's going to have a wonderful outpost on e5. But white's opening up things, weakening the black king side. And as expected, there comes that knight into e5. And now the battle lines are drawn. Black's saying, I'm going to lock up the king side the best I can. I'm covering the key squares. And it's up to white's imagination to try to find a continuation to break the black king position open. And I think White found a very interesting way to do this, and we'll see in just a minute or two, since we get closer to the key move. Okay, these are kind of natural and expected, the h4 type moves. Now he gets the other knight into play. That queen has just been busy, hasn't really done much. He's just been moving around and around and around, and now comes the point where I say White found an interesting way to pursue his attack. There's a threat on the pawn on e4, and there's a threat on the rook on c1. So if and there's a threat on the pawn on b2. I mean, if you're black, you have to be happy here. And even after what White plays, you have to be happy here. It's my opinion the game's been dynamically even all the way. There's never anything concrete and clear. There's just maybe different ideas to test and try. And White comes up with a novel solution here. He decides to sacrifice the exchange. And then the question is, does Black have enough for it, or does White have enough for it? Well, this move does serve the function. He wasn't attacking b2, by the way. He was just pressuring the square. It does solve the question of what to do with the pawn on e4. And Black takes it. And now let's just stop and take a quick stock of this. One thing about giving up the exchange is it gives you an extra minor piece. And a lot of times people don't think of the material in this respect. When you're attacking in a close position, a minor piece is often as worth as much, and in some cases more than a rook. The weakness of the minor piece against the rook really shows itself in the end game. And if you're down an exchange or quality, as they call it in Europe, in an ending, and the position's opened up, the minor piece is in trouble. It's gonna be defeated. But here, in effect, it gives White an extra attacker against the king. White has three minor pieces, Black has two. So it's not an exchange sacrifice isn't that bad of a deal here. White has two knights and Black has none. And even though Black has two bishops, look at them. They really don't have any place to go. That's the black bishop on f8. Any place it moves, it's going to be captured. So it's just a defensive piece. And the bishop on b3 is not influencing matters much. It's looking for squares. So Black doesn't really have a whole lot except a material advantage. And Black's now missing a knight that was a while ago helping out his defense just fine on e5, and then it looked like it was on a tremendous square on d3. And now for the price of a rook, White has eliminated it. So the only question now is, can White generate enough stuff with his remaining material to get up that white king? And now, for what it's worth, in some positions, White might be trying to get ready to bust open the king position with e5. And who knows, maybe this bishop on c3, which is serving as a tall pawn, could later come into play on this diagonal. So Black doesn't really have an answer for those two knights in the center. I don't know if White probably has full compensation for the exchange positionally. It's just that if Black can get down to an ending, this game will be over in Black's favor. And here I think Black missed a good move. Okay, the one black white has two breaks in this position, and that's it. Okay, h5 and e6. Now, it's the h5 break can't be stopped, but the e6 break can be. And I think it's time to just play bishop f5 here. Then this bishop can drop back to e6 if need be, and that will assure that this bishop here on c3 remains a tall pawn, and then maybe black can remaneuver things and launch a pawn minority attack here and get some counterplay. So I think this was black's best choice. But, you know, you can't fault black for what he does. It's just this white just plays this well from this point on in. And now comes, eventually this was going to come. But, you see, eventually this e6 break is coming, and there's not going to be too much black can do about it. And I think there were some opportunities to play it here and there. It's worth examination beyond the scope of this video, but even here it was possible, I think. It can get tricky here. e6, let's see, we'll take a little bit. If you take with the rook, let's see. There were some positions where I was looking at that white can throw this extra g6 in, and the idea is it clears a few invasion squares, and it might undermine the rook on e6. It might prepare an f7 check if black takes with the f-pawn. White had some ways to attack, and I can't quite go into them all. It just gets lengthy and not that I couldn't do it. It's just that I think that the key point has been passed when black missed a clear blockade of that square. By parking the bishop on that square would have made the e6 move impossible. Once that kind of passed, it's just been a matter of who can maneuver their pieces the better. And here, just in this position, if you look at it, everything black owns is on the back rank, with the exception of the bishop on f5, right? So black hasn't really done much with his material advantage, not to mention his material period. They're not active. Okay, so now the king starts marching up the field. And here he's going the wrong way with the bishop. I don't know what the bishop's doing there. It's better to just park it on e6. If it sits here, it's always going to be a thorn in... maybe he can't do it now. H7 is going to start getting weak here. Rook h1. Yeah, it's kind of past the point where black could have tried to park a defender over there, but we'll go back and look at some possibilities here in a minute, because I want to cover... let's go forward. I want to cover a couple things here that could have happened. Now the g6 move comes, and white's breaking this position open. I think white's winning now, and that's a very nice move. The king can't take. There comes... Just all kinds of problems. This is falling with check, and this will fall next with check, and the white king is, or the black king isn't long for this world here. Check, where are you going to go? You can't go to e7, you drop your bishop. You go here, and white just has all kinds of attacking possibilities. It's not even funny what white can do here. Anyway, he goes in the corner, and that allows a discovered check, and then boom, there that bishop that's been so useless all this game, it's come into play. And I think somebody pointed out in the notes that white missed an interesting win, and he did. Probably more than one here. This one's interesting. I think this is the one that's given. There's only one legal move here, and after this, it sure looks to me like white has a forced mate. How does black get out of checkmate here? The king has no legal move, and rook takes h6 is threatened. So I don't even see a spy check for black. So I think this was the mate somebody pointed out in the notes. But really, it doesn't matter. Anything wins here. Now suddenly, white's a piece ahead. He's won his rook, and the rest of it's just routine. Just start liquidating. And really, there's no hope for black. Now, black just obliges and trades queens, but white finds a better move. Trade when he wants to trade. And now get this pawn ready to run. If the rook moves e7, followed by knight f6 is going to assure the pawn promotion, so black gets tricky. But white just gets out of it with a check, and then black resigns. So it's a nice attack, and the exchange sack certainly was interesting. The only question, like I was saying, I was suggesting bishop f5 earlier instead of queen c6. Let's back up to that point and maybe play out a couple things, see what we can come up with. Because I think that was the critical stage. See, the idea is to get the bishop to e6 and blockade. So let's go about with White's plan. Okay, White's plan, only other plan is to break open something on the h file, right? Now I was going ahead with this move, right? Now let's take here, and let's see. Does White have a winning attack now on the h file? It's a good question. You need to get the queen over here at some point. The point being, if Black brings the bishop out and creates some flight squares for the king, the minute the king gets to f8, you stop and checkmate him. So now the threat of White's is to bring the rook to e3, h3, and mate on the back rank. Well, I'm going here as quickly as I can. There's been one drawback in this position all along, and that's the fact that what Black could win a piece here. Let's see, check. And the question is, does White have enough here? Is White threatening to do this, and is Black defenseless? My gut instinct is Black should survive this. Let's see. So, for instance, if we bring the queen into f3, that stops rook e2, and it stops rook d1. Black's going to occupy the d file here in a minute. White's struggling to find a mate down here, so White can't give up a piece. The moment Black comes to e6, he's threatening to win a piece, so White's going to have to come up with something different other than what I played. So if you bring the rook over to e1, it can get pinned. The other alternative is to redeploy the knight, and Black gets this check in anyway. Where are you going to put the king? G1, H2. Either way, it's going to maybe put it on H2 so that the rook can come over. Now the question is, can Black survive this? And if he allows this pawn to take on G6, and my thinking is he can. Centralizing the queen good. Now if the knight comes over here with a discovery, we can go threaten the knight. Well, White can come back, but it might lead to a draw. Not necessarily, but let's see. Let's back up the queen. Let's not get so quickly aggressive here. What's White threatening? It's several moves to set up what he wants. Rook h1, king there, and queen over just to get, and then open up the file just to give the mate. Black gets some moves too, in all fairness. So just in case, let's bring this rook to the d file to control the file and to create a potential flight square for the black king. So now White needs to go into this, and as I was saying earlier, get the queen to h4 so that if the black king runs to f8, there's a checkmate. Okay, so how does Black deal with this? White needs rook h1, king g3, and queen here to give a mate. Okay, that takes a few moves. It's black's turn. Let's see. How about if we put the rook on d3 just for the sake of sticking it there? And now let's go ahead with this move. But that gives up the piece. And now when we give here, now there's the threat. The threat is made on two different squares. What can black do to prevent all this? We can give up the queen on h1. That'll give him two rooks for the queen. If push comes to shove, black can do that. Let's see. There may be a better defense. I'm just trying to give some examples. Okay, who's better off here? It's not clear where white's going to make any progress. The queen's threatening to take this pawn. The knight's threatening to maybe take here and get white a protected pass pawn. How about if we go threaten all kinds of discovered checks, so that if if white takes on b7, this falls with check. That should be in black's favor. So now king runs over here to get out of that danger. Now let's see. Got to be careful about this possibility, but if we have to, we can always drop the bishop back. How about if we slide the rook over here and threaten a back rank check? Okay, so we'll play this. And the check certainly looks good. Now king can't come to f2 because rook h3 check, so king runs over here. And looks like the black rooks got very active here. Got to deal with this mate threat at some point. Maybe now, because we're out of checks. And where's the queen going to go? H4, I suppose. I mean, this is just one variation. It looks to me like black's now got the better of it. So, bishop e6, I think, was a better move in principle, simply because it took away a possibility of white getting e6 in, because he's eventually able to get it in and get that bishop on c3 activated. And once that happened, white got that bishop in the game. It was over. So it was a good exchange sacrifice by white. It was a well-played game by white, certainly deserving of a game of the week. And plenty of possibilities. I could spend 3 hours analyzing this video simply because there was so much to it. And I want to thank you for taking the time to look at it. And I'll be back when the winner is selected for round 2. Take care. Thanks.